I'm Susan Carlson. We're happy to be here today with Ron Watkins, who is the Associate Dean of the Geese College of Business, as well as a new role that he's taking on with Shield Illinois, the University of Illinois program, which is having incredible breakthroughs when it comes to COVID testing. Good to be with you today, Ron.
Thanks, Susan. I appreciate the time.
Well, we've heard about the saliva test for COVID-19, but tell us about how U of I handled this last fall. We know so many schools were shuttered. They were forced to do remote learning. How was U of I able to stay open during this pandemic?
Not just because I worked there or an alum, but I'm really proud of the University of Illinois and really what the science team pulled off. So led by Marty Burke, Paul Hergenrother, Tim Fan, so many others, they were able to develop this really incredible, accurate saliva-based test that makes it so that we can get results quickly and take a offensive approach, which allows us to get students back on campus, as opposed to sitting and waiting around to see what was going to happen. They really stepped out and made it so that we could get back on campus, and I appreciate them for that.
Fantastic. Now, by March of 2021, we're hearing that U of I had performed more than 1.5 million tests across all their universities, and they have kept these positivity rates extraordinarily low. And that's fantastic news in itself, but the story doesn't end there. This is now leading to the project that you're in charge of, trying to deploy these tests throughout the state.
We're a land-grant institution, and it's part of our mission to the state and the people to be able to take this incredible technology that was developed at the Champaign-Urbana campus and really make it accessible to the state. We've seen those positivity rates well below 1% on a 7-day rolling average at the University of Illinois, even when surrounding us, it was 10, 13%. So how do we get that out to the state? Well, we come up with a low-cost model that allows the test to be accessible. And so to do that, we had to build labs across the state. We had to find ways of essentially doing this in a way to keep those costs down and really give a tool to our schools, businesses, government to be able to have access to a test that they can use to safely open.
So Ron, explain to us, what are the key parts in this test that makes it superior to others?
It's a PCR-based saliva test, where we're getting results in less than 24 hours. We're generally even less than 12. But imagine the gold standard test that you can get in less than 24 hours. It's really easy to administer, extremely high accuracy. So we have real high sensitivity, so it catches the virus, and we have almost no false positives. So we can use it in that offensive approach, and it's really low cost. And additionally, it's easy to administer. It doesn't take a healthcare professional. Literally anybody can collect it.
That is amazing. And you know, you hear about so many efforts that are underway currently to stop the spread, and everything seems to come from a defensive posture. But this test is different because it really puts everything on the offense. Can you explain how that happens?
Probably the most exciting part of the test, at least for me, is what we have been taking is, as you mentioned, a defensive approach. We wait until someone has symptoms. We wait to then go check and see whether or not they have COVID or don't. What's great about this test is you can use it in a way that we're able to catch the asymptomatic. We're able to catch those who are in a pre-carrier stage. We're able to allow institutions to confidently open through this approach where we're testing each individual, and therefore we're stopping the virus and stopping it early and stopping it before it can create a spread within whatever that institution may be.
People watching this video may be curious, has this been authorized by the FDA?
Yeah, so it has been. We do have the emergency use authorization from the FDA. In addition to that, we had already set up all of our labs in terms of being a laboratory developed test. And so we went through extensive validations to get the laboratory developed test. And then we got the FDA emergency use authorization. And so yes, we are authorized and we are ready to go.
So who is getting tested and how often is the testing taking place?
Ideally, we're testing everyone, whether you've been vaccinated or not. Even if you've been vaccinated, you can still spread the virus. We're testing everyone and we want to test as often as possible. And ideally, even those who have potentially a higher risk factor because of the number of contacts that they may have, or it may be part of their job, or they may be involved in athletics or something that has more contacts per day. So ideally, we're testing everyone and testing those with more contacts even more often.
Now, this particular test is a what's called PCR test. Now, for the average layperson, explain to us, why is that better? What makes that the gold standard?
And so this is where there has been a lot of misinformation or it gets a little bit confusing. So let me take a minute to explain. The two primary test types that are out is a molecular test, which is the PCR-based test. And then there's the antigen test, which is really detecting viral proteins. So the molecular test, it's testing at the viral gene versus the antigen test testing at the viral protein. So let's break the two of those down. The molecular test. Ideally, you're getting results within 24 hours. For us, we're averaging just under 12. You may have heard how test results that were lab-based were coming back 3 and 4 days later. There's really not a lot of use to that. You need to have the lab results ideally within 48, but really you want to get it within 24 hours. So a molecular test that does that, the advantages are you're going to have really low false positives, and it's going to be an extremely sensitive test, so it's going to have really high accuracy. The other piece is then it allows to take that offensive approach because of the high sensitivity, and you don't want to have false positives, because if you're out testing everyone, creating false positives can actually create problems because you have to treat each one the same as if it's a positive. Now let's take that versus the antigen test. The antigen test, it will have a really quick 15 to 45 minute turnaround. But the problem is its sensitivity is low. It does create more false positives, but it especially misses for the time period at which someone, if they're not symptomatic, or if they aren't in that, essentially in that infection period. So where the antigen test works so well is once someone exhibits symptoms, you have cause for concern, that's where the antigen test has great sensitivity. That's where it's a wonderful tool. And that's where you want to pull it out and do the quick 15 to 45 minute test but then let's say someone does come positive. You still need to get a PCR test to confirm that because it's just overall lower sensitivity of the antigen test.
So we're seeing a lot of advertising right now, fast test results, COVID testing here, get results within minutes. So you're saying those tests that are being pushed as the 15-minute solution don't always have accurate results compared to your test?
Oh yeah, there's not even a comparison between the two. So let's say you want to take the offensive approach. Using the antigen test, and a really popular one would be the Binext Now. Using that test, it's not the right test for using in a screening or surveillance type of mode or an offensive mode, but it's a tremendous defensive test. So then once someone pops, great, grab the antigen, let's check. But if we want to open up an institution, a workplace, a school, and we want to take the offensive approach, well, then we need to have a more robust testing program that doesn't create false positives and that can catch folks that are asymptomatic or even pre-carriers to have that safe environment. The Binext Now, the antigen test, isn't going to do that. So that's where we have to put in place the molecular test. And if you're going to put in place this molecular test or the PCR-based test, then what better test to use than one that uses saliva that's non-invasive as opposed to one that is nasal or one that requires healthcare providers to collect versus ours, anybody can collect. So that's what makes it so easy to put an institution to be able to allow them to have a safe way of opening and having this offensive option with that antigen as a defensive option in their back pocket.
One more question regarding comparison of the testing, and I'm hammering this home so that everybody's very clear on this, but the people who get the tests that are not what is advertised as fast results, and they have to wait 3 or 4 days. And yet you're saying you can get a very accurate result within 24 hours. How can that even be possible compared to everybody else missing the boat and not being able to get even close to the same level?
As more and more capacity or lab capability has been put in place, the resulting times in general have been coming down. I would say that the most now are at that 48 hour mark. We're still within the 24 hours and usually within 12 hours. And the big reasons why we're able to do it so quickly is that process that the scientists developed took out this extraction process. They took out the RNA extraction that happens, which all that means is they essentially reduced the time that it takes for us to test by 1.5 to 2 hours. And it doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're running a really high volume of tests, it makes a huge difference. The other thing is we've put in a lot more checkout lines, a lot more lab capacity. So think of it as if you're at the grocery store and you're going to go check out and there's a long line waiting ahead of you. Well, if all the checkout lines were open, think of how quickly you are able to check out and get through the grocery store. That's essentially the other approach we've done is we've created more of those lines in an already faster process that the scientists put together, which allows us in turn to get the quick results, which then allows us to quickly mitigate the virus by getting those fast results to an individual who may or may not know that they even have COVID.
Wow, that makes sense. And that clarifies a lot. You mentioned this is a saliva-based test. What is the advantage of taking the sample through saliva as opposed to all of these nasal tests where we see people on the news suffering through a very invasive procedure?
Yeah, so as we've talked about and you alluded to, the procedure itself is really easy. It's non-invasive, right? You literally just drool into a tube. But the other piece on saliva is there's many more copies of the gene that is in the saliva. So it allows for that high accuracy. And the other piece about our test in particular is because we're doing the three gene look, the ability to then two of the three genes have to show up for us to know that someone's positive. That helps us with keeping the false positives down. It helps us with being more sensitive and accurate. It also helps us with catching the mutations and the different variants out there versus the most of the nasal tests today on the PCR-based, that those are one gene looks. And actually all the other saliva-based tests that we've seen so far are one gene looks. So ours is superior to those in multiple ways, the collection, the accuracy, and our ability to deal with what may be coming down the line with this virus as it mutates.
You're referring to, I'm assuming, these new variants that we keep hearing about. A lot of people hear about this and they're very scared that the technology won't be able to keep up, but you're saying you guys are ahead of the game there too.
Yeah, it's a tremendous partnership we have. We're using the Thermo Fisher test. Thermo Fisher Scientific has done a tremendous job of helping to stay on top of it. So think of that as that's the reagent, that's the test kit that we're using to test the saliva that's coming through. And it's wonderful because they've developed this test that does the 3 gene look that we've been able to deploy to the saliva. It's amazing.
So you've sold me. This sounds like a fantastic way to determine where people are and to clear people when they need to be cleared for certain events or occasions. Walk me through the procedure. I'm going to get tested. What can I expect?
Yeah, it's way easier than people assume. And after you do it once or twice, it's like nothing. It takes 3 minutes. So what happens is someone walks up and, hi, Susan, how are you? I just need to verify that it's you. You know, can I check your street address or date of birth? Great. Now that we know that it's you, I scan a vial and that vial has now been tied to you. I scan a barcode. It's on the vial. I hand you the vial. You walk over, you drool into the vial, you drop it to a tray and you leave. So the entire process It's about 3 minutes. Maybe the first time you go through, it could take five, it could take 6 minutes. It's just sort of figuring out, seeing what's going on. But that's it. And that's what makes this incredibly easy to deploy. And by the way, I, as a person administering the test and giving it to you, I don't have to be a healthcare professional. I go through the HIPAA training we have. I go through an understanding of how to ensure that I'm following the proper procedures that protects information, and I'm able to administer the test.
That makes it so much easier too. Is there anything you should or shouldn't do when you're deciding that it's you're going to go for this test?
So we want to have clean saliva. And so an hour before testing, we ask that the individual has not been eating or drinking anything. We really want to avoid bits of donut in the sample, things that'll stop the procedure from actually happening accurately. So one of the things that will happen, especially early on when we establish sites, is we'll be sort of training people to make sure that they understand as they're walking through that that saliva needs to be clean.
Wow. And you said too, there's the code on the vial. Then how are you notified of your results?
That barcode that's on there, it's how we know, of course, to who to result it to, because there isn't any other identifying information that's on there. So the vial comes through the lab, it runs through the process, and when the vial is scanned into the lab, that now ties, not only is it already tied to you, it's now tied to you and to the lab procedure. So once it runs through the PCR machine actually sends the result directly to a web, to your individual web portal or to the school. If the school is handling it for, say, your fourth grader, Susan. And so if it's going to the school for your fourth grader, the school will receive it, and then they'll be able to contact the parents. They'll be able to work on taking the proper mitigation procedures. If it's going to the individual, you'll receive an email, you'll receive a notification, and you'll log into your personal portal, and you'll be able to see your result.
A lot of people watching this video may be very curious to get more information and find out how they can get access to this particular test too. What can you tell us?
Yeah, Susan, we'd be very excited to work with folks to get the test out there. That's what we're here for. And so ideally, you know, you're a school, you're a company, you're an individual who's running a very large event, such as a convention or trade show, and you'd like to open that safely, you'd like for us to be a part of it, then you can go to shieldillinois.com. It's just that simple. It's shieldillinois.com. And you'd have the ability to click on asking for more information. We'll just get some basic info so we know how to follow back up with you.
So at this point, is the test accessible to people who want it, or are we still in the building phase?
Well, it's a great question. We've got 7 labs that are up throughout the state. We are ready to help the state at a very large scale. We are unable to help folks that, say, just want to buy a test or pick up a test off the street. They would still need to go to one of the community-based testing sites. So what we're here for is we're here to help entities get back up and running.
And that's an area where the need is great, and you are fulfilling that need. So Ron, on behalf of everybody watching, I just want to thank you for the work you're doing to protect Illinois.
Well, I appreciate that. It's not necessarily the work that I'm doing. It's the work that our Shield Illinois team is out doing. But it is impressive what they've done so far. We're at 30 plus colleges and universities. We've helped the federal court system, the state legislator, and as of today, 12 different school districts with getting up and going, not to mention 3 large manufacturers and a national lab. And so we look forward to deploying it even further across the state.
Well, don't be humble. Your contributions are significant. And we want to thank Shield Illinois. And of course, thank you for explaining all of this to us today.
Absolutely. My pleasure. Thank you, Susan.